skin is black. My arms are long.
For quite some time now. Let me introduce myself. My name is Trista Powers. I teach English here at the Metropolitan campus, and I was able to, some time ago, come to the former Associate Dean, Dr. Jocelyn Ladner, about 2 years ago, and just share with her a vision that I had. As an English professor, we do quite a number of varying projects in our classes, and one of the items that I always like to introduce is African American literature in my class. I teach college composition, and we have so many powerful discussions about the text that we explore in my classes. And I thought to myself, well, why don't we have something that would allow students to engage in experiential learning beyond the class? And lo and behold, the blessing of Voices from the Village, collaborating with the Cleveland Humanities Collaborative, was able to allow this project to come to fruition. And we call it Theater to Class. We've been able to, this is our third installment of Theater to Class, where there are multiple classes, English classes and other classes from other disciplines, where students are studying the work of Ntozake Shange. And so today, we have some powerful talent that's going to grace our stage to bring for colored girls who have considered suicide, When the Rainbow is Enough, by Ntozake Shange. And the women are going to just bring forth some very powerful stories that we probably have encountered in our own lives in some capacity or another, and give an opportunity for us to dialogue about this at the talkback after the show. I definitely want to make sure that I acknowledge the director, Jimmie Woody. Please, Jimmie, please stand. Come on, Jimmie.
Like wine.
Dark phrases of womanhood, of never having been a girl, half notes, scattered without rhythm, no tune, distraught laughter, falling over a black girl's shoulder. It's funny, it's hysterical, the melodylessness of her dance. Don't tell nobody, don't tell a soul that she's dancing on beer cans and shingles. This must be the spook house. Another song with no singers, lyrics, no voices, interrupted solos, unseen performances. Are we ghouls, children of horror, the joke? Don't tell nobody, don't tell a soul. Are we animals? Have we gone crazy? I can't seem to hear anything but maddening screams and the soft strains of death. And you promised me, somebody, anybody, sing a black girl's song, bring her out to know herself, to know you, but sing a rhythm. Care and struggle, hard times, sing her song of life. She's been dead so long, closed in silence so long, she doesn't even know the sound of her own voice. Her infinite beauty, she is half notes, scattered without rhythm, no tune. Sing her sighs, sing her possibilities, sing the righteous gospel. Let her be born, let her be born and handled warmly. I'm outside Chicago.
I'm outside Detroit.
I'm outside Houston. I'm outside Baltimore.
I'm outside San Francisco.
I'm outside Manhattan.
I'm outside St. Louis.
I'm outside Fort Myers.
I'm outside Atlanta.
And I'm outside Cleveland.
And this is for colored girls who have considered suicide but have moved to the ends of their own rainbows. Ready?
To the west.
dangling our tassels from the rearview mirror. Yeah, climbing different sort of project stairs and moving toward snapping beer cans and get it. That's the way to do it, Mama. Oh, Mercer County graduated the same night. Cosmetology, secretarial, pre-college, and auto shopping business, all us moving from Mama to whatever was out there. That night we raced a big old truck from the barbecue stand, trying to tell them at the party at Jackie's, where folks graduated last year, was waiting to hit it with us. Ooh, yes they was. I got so drunk and couldn't figure out whose hair was on my thigh. But honey, it didn't matter, cause these cousins, Martin, Eddie, Jerome, and Bobby, ooh, they was my sweethearts. Alternately, since the seventh grade, and everybody knew I would always start crying if somebody actually tried to take advantage of me at Jackie's. Yolanda Mason was sticking up my fallout while we tumbled out that Buick. Ooh, Eddie Jones was her licking stick. But I knew how to dance. He was leaving for the Navy in the morning, had to kick ass so everybody would know how bad he was. Seemed like Sheila and Marguerite was afraid to get their head turning back, so they laid up against the wall, looking almost sexy. But me and my fellas, honey, we was dancing. We was dancing. Since 1963, I've won all kind of contest with the cousins at the Police Athletic League dances. Yes, honey, all Mercer County knew. Any Kendall Martin Yates could turn some somersaults, but Smokey Robinson, we could get a woman excited. Yes, we danced, doing nasty old tricks, doing nasty tricks as I had been thinking about since May. Cause graduation night, yes, it had to be hot. And I was the only virgin. So I had to make like my hips was into some business. And that way everybody thought that whoever was getting it was an older man. Oh no, couldn't run the streets with no youngsters, honey. Ooh, Martin slipped his leg around my thigh. And the deals, they bumped stay up and down, up and down. New Carver Homes, we was grown. We was finally grown. Yeah, Yolanda all of a sudden went crazy, went up to Eddie and started cussing and carrying on, tearing at his skin with her nails. The cousins tried to talk some sense into her, tried to hold her arms. Listen, bitch, Sammy went on. Bobby whispered to me, I should go with him before they go to cutting. For the police arrived. So we teethered silently through that parking lot and we didn't know nothing about no party, honey. Bobby started looking at me. He started looking at me real strange. Like I was a woman, something. Ooh, started talking real soft in the back seat of that old black Buick. Oh, wow! By daybreak, honey, I just couldn't stop grinning.
You gave it up in a Buick?
Yeah, honey, and it was wonderful.
To the South Bronx, cause I was gonna meet up with Willie Colon and dance all the time. Mambo, bomba,
do you speak Spanish?
Hola. My papa thought we was Puerto Rican, and we would have been. Except we was just regular niggas with hints of Spanish. So, off I made it to this 36-hour marathon dance con salsa con Ricardo. Sugar Ray on Southern Boulevard, next door to this photography place jammed with burial wedding and communion relics, next door to La Real Ideal, genuine Spanish bar. Up, 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 stairs and stairs and lots of hallways with my color New Jersey self. Didn't know what anybody was saying, except if dancing was proof of origin, I was Ibarita herself that night and the next day. I was smiling and right on stepping. If he could lead, I was ready to dance. If he couldn't lead, I caught this attitude I'd seen Rosa do and would not be bothered. I was twirling and hipping and giving much quick feet to being a cute, mute, cute colored Puerto Rican. Till Saturday afternoon when the dish jockey say,
"Sorry folks, Willie Cologne ain't gonna make it today."
And all of my nigga temper came out of control and I wouldn't dance with nobody. And I talk English loud. I love you more than I was mad. More than when I discovered Archie Shepp in Subtle Blues. Don't you know I wore out the magic of juju, heroically resisting being possessed. Ooh, the sounds. Sneaking in the slugs underage to stare at a real artiste. And every word out of Imamu's mouth was gospel. And if Jesus couldn't play a horn like Shepp, wasn't no need for color folks to bear no cross at all. And my poem is my thank you for music. I love you more than poem. More than Arliano Buendia loved Mancando. More than Hector Lavoe loved himself. More than the lady loved Gardenias. More than Celia loves Cuba or Graciela loves El Son. More than the flamingo, Shudu, and Dua love being pretty. Oye, negro. Te amo más que when you play your flute. Te amo más que. Te amo más que.
Without any assistance or guidance from you, I have loved you assiduously for 8 months, 2 weeks, and a day. I have been stood up 4 times. I've left 7 packages on your doorsteps, 40 poems, 2 plans, and 3 homemade note cards that I left town so I could send to you. And you have been no help to me on my job. Call at 3 o'clock in the morning on weekdays so that I could drive 27 and a half miles across the bay before I go to work. Charming, charming, but you are of no assistance. I want you to know that this was an experiment to see how selfish I could be. If I could snare a possible lover, if I was capable of debasing myself for the love of another, if I could stand not being wanted when I wanted to be wanted, and I cannot, so with no further assistance or guidance from you, I am ending this affair. This note is attached to a plant that I've been watering since the day that I met you. You may water it your damn self.
I don't want to write in English or Spanish. I want to sing, make you dance like the body dance. Scream! Twitch hits with me because I done forgot all about words. Ain't got no definitions. I want to whirl with you. Our whole bodies wrapped like a ripe mango, rambling, whipping through space. On the corner in the park where the rug used to be. Let Willie Cologne take you out, swing your head, twitch, push your legs to the moon with me. I'm on the Lower East Side, New York City, and I can't talk with you no more.
We gotta dance to keep from crying. We gotta dance to keep from dying. So come on. Come on.
Come on.
Hold your hand like a ruby sapphire. I am a poet who writes in English. Come to share the worlds with you.
Come to share our worlds with you. We gonna get to dance, to be dancing, to be dancing. Bye.
Friend is hard to press charges against.
If you knew him, you must have wanted it.
A misunderstanding, you know these things happen.
Are you sure you didn't suggest?
Had you been drinking?
A rapist is always a good strike. To be legitimate, someone you never saw a man
Pinups attached to the inside of his lapels. Ticket stubs from porno flicks in his pocket.
Little dick.
Or a strong mother.
Or just a brutal virgin.
But if you've been seen in public with them, danced one dance, kissed them goodbye lightly, closed mouth.
Pressing charges will be as hard as keeping your legs closed while five fools try to run a train on you.
These men, friends of ours who smile nice, stay employed and take us out to dinner.
Lock the door behind you.
With fist and face to fuck.
Who make elaborate Mediterranean dinners and let the art ensemble carry out all ethical burdens. Well, they invite a couple of friends over to have you, are suffering from latent rapist bravado, and we are left with the scars, being betrayed by men who know us.
And expect, like the stranger we always thought was coming, that we will submit. We must have known.
Women relinquish all personal rights in the presence of a man who apparently could be considered a rapist.
Especially if he's been considered a friend.
And is no less worthy of being beat with an inch of his life, publicly ridiculed, having two fists shoved up his ass.
Stranger we always thought it would be, never showed up.
Thus it turns out, the nature of rape has changed.
We can now meet them in circles we frequent for companionship.
We see them at the coffee house with someone else we know.
We could even have them over for dinner. And get raped in our own houses by invitation, a friend.
Eyes. Mice.
Nobody.
Tubes, tables, whitewashed windows, grime from age wiped over once, legs spread, anxious. Eyes crawling up on me, eyes rolling in my thighs, metal horses gnawing my womb. Dead mice fall from my mouth. I really didn't mean to. I really didn't think I could just one day off, get off of me all this blood, bone shattered like soft ice cream cones. I couldn't have people looking at me pregnant. I couldn't have my friends see this dying dangling between my legs, and I didn't make a sound, not a sigh or a fast scream to get them eyes off of me, get them steel rods out of me. This hurts. This hurts me. And nobody came, because nobody knew. Once I was pregnant and ashamed of myself.
But God bless the child that's got his own, that's got his own.
Once, there were quadroon balls, elegance in St. Louis, laced mulattoes gambling down the Mississippi to Memphis, New Orleans, and okra crepes near the bayou, where the poor white trash would sing, moaning strange liquid tones through the swamps. Satyra had heard these things. She moved as if she knew them. The silver and high tone laughing, the violins and marble floors. Satyra pushed the clinging delta dust with painted toes. The patchwork tent was polka dotted, stale lights snatched at the shadows, Creole carnivals playing Natchez in 10 minutes. Her splendid red garters, gin stained and itchy on her thighs, black diamond stockings darned with yellow threads. An old starched taffeta can-can fell abundantly orange from her waist round the splintering chair. Seshida, Egyptian goddess of creativity, second millennium, threw her heavy hair in a coil over her neck. Seshida, goddess, the recording of history, spread crimson oil on her cheeks, waxed her eyebrows, and unconsciously slugged the last hard whiskey in the glass. The broken mirror she used to decorate her face made her forehead tilt backwards, her cheeks appear sunken, her sassy chin only large enough to support her full lower lip to keep it from growing into her neck. Seshida had learned to make allowances for the distortions. But the heavy dust of the Delta left a tinge of grit and darkness on every one of her dresses, on her arms and her shoulders. Seshida was anxious to get back to St. Louis. The dirt there didn't crawl from the earth into your soul. At least in St. Louis, the grime was store-bought, secondhand. Here in Natchez, God seemed to be wiping his feet on her face. One of the wrestlers had finally won. Tonight, the mulatto, Raul, was supposed to hold the booming half-caste, Searing Eagle, in a bear hug. 8 counts, get thrown unawares, fall out of the ring, and then do Searing Eagle in for good. Seshida could hear the redneck whoops and slapping on the back. She gathered her sparsely sequined skirts, tugged the waist cincher from under her graying slips, and made her face immobile. She made her face like Nefertiti approaching her own tomb. She suddenly threw her leg full force through the canvas curtain. A deceptive glass stone sparkled malignant on her ankle. Her calf was taunting in the brazen carny lights, the full moon. Seshida, goddess of love, Egypt, second millennium, performing the rites, the conjuring of men, conjuring the spirit. In Natchez, the Mississippi spewed a heavy fume of barely moving waters. Seshida's legs slashed furiously through the crack of night and gold pieces hitting the makeshift stage. Her thighs, they were aiming coins between her thighs. Seshida, Egyptian goddess harmony, kicked viciously through the night, catching stars tween her toes.
The library was right down from the trolley tracks, across from the laundromat, through the big shining floors and granite pillars old St. Louis was famous for. I found Toussaint. But not till after months of Cage and Katie, Pippi Longstocking, Christopher Robin, Eddie Haywood, and a Pooh Bear in the children's room. Only Pioneer Girls and Magic Rabbits and Big City White Boys now. I knew I wasn't supposed to, but I ran into the adult reading room and came across Toussaint, my first black man. I didn't really count George Washington Carr because I'm allergic to peanuts. Still, Toussaint was a black man. A Negro, like my mama say, who refused to be a slave, and he spoke French, and he didn't let no white man tell him nothing. Not Napoleon, not Maximilian, not Robespierre. Toussaint Louverture was the beginning of reality for me. In the summer contest for Whose Colored Child Could Read 15 Books in 3 Weeks, I won and raved about Toussaint Louverture at the afternoon ceremony, but was disqualified because Toussaint belonged in the adult reading room, and I cried and carried dead Toussaint home with me. But he was dead living to me, because Toussaint and him held the citadel against the French, where the spirits of old dead Africans come out the ground. Toussaint led their army of zombies, walking cannonballs, shooting spirits to free Haiti. And they weren't slaves no more. Toussaint Louverture became my secret lover at the age of 8. I entertained him in my bedroom. Way into the night, we discussed strategies on how to remove white girls from my hopscotch games and etc. Toussaint was laying in bed with me and Raggedy Ann the night I decided to run away from my integrated home, integrated street, integrated school. Because 1955 was not a good year for little black girls. Toussaint said, "Let's go to Haiti." I said, "All right." And I packed some very important things in a brown paper bag so I wouldn't have to come back. Then Toussaint and I took the Haudemont streetcar to the river. Last stop, only 15 cents. Because there wasn't nobody could see Toussaint except me.
We walked all down through North St. Louis where the French settlers used to live, in tiny brick houses all huddled together with barely missing windows and shingles uneven, with colored kids playing and women in low porches sipping beer. I could talk to Tucson down by the river like this was we was gonna stow away on a boat for New Orleans and catch a Creole fishing rig from Port-au-Prince. Then we could just walk and talk and eat fried bananas. We was just walking and skipping past old drunk men when I saw a young boy jumped out of me saying,
"Hey gal, you better come over here and talk to me."
Well, I turned to Tucson, who was furious. And I shouted, "You silly old boy, you better leave me alone or Tucson's gonna get your ass." Silly old boy came around the corner laughing in my face.
"Yellow gal, you must be somebody to know my name so quick."
I was disgusted. And I wanted to go to Haiti without some tacky old boy bothering me. Still, he kept standing there, kicking bits of brick and milk cartons, trying to get all in my business. I mumbled to Lil' Vitor, "Well, what should I do?" Finally asked silly old boy, "Well, who are you?" He say,
"My name, Tucson Jones."
Well, I looked right at him. Those skidded out corduroy pants, a striped t-shirt with holes in both elbows, a new scab over his left eye, and I said, "What's your name again?" He say,
"I'm Tucson Jones."
"Wow, well, I'm on my way to see Tucson Louverture in Haiti. Are you any kin to him?" "He don't take no stuff from no white folks, and they got a country all their own. They ain't no slaves." The silly old boy squinted his face all up.
"Look here, girl, I'm Tucson Jones, and I'm right here looking at you, and I don't take no stuff from no white folks. You don't see none around here, do you?"
He sort of pushed out his chest, and he said,
"Come on, let's go down to the docks and look at the boats."
I was real puzzled going down to the dock with my paper bag in my boots. So I felt Toussaint Louverture so leave me. And I was sad till I realized Toussaint Louverture wasn't so different from Toussaint Jones. Except the old one was in Haiti, and this one was with me, speaking English and eating apples. Yeah, Toussaint Jones was all right with me. Ain't no telling what old spirits we could move down by the river, North St. Louis, 1955. Hey, wait!
Orange butterflies and aqua sequins, ensconced between slight bosoms. Silk roses darting from behind her ears. The passion flower of Southwest Los Angeles. Meander down Hoover Street, past dark shuttered houses where women from Louisiana shell peas around 3 o'clock and sent their sons to the store for fatback and black eyed peas. She glittered in heat and seemed to be looking for rides when she wasn't, and absolutely eyed every man who wasn't lame, white, or nodding out. She let her thigh slip from her skirt crossing the street. She slowed to be examined and never looked back to smile or acknowledge a sincere, "Hey mama," or to meet the eyes of someone purposely finding something to do in her direction. She was sullen, and the rhinestones etching the corners of her mouth suggested tears, fresh kisses that had done no good. She always wore her stomach out, lined with small iridescent feathers, and the hairs around her navel seemed to dance, and she didn't let on. She knew from behind her waist was aching to be held, the pastel ivy drawn on her shoulder to be brushed with lips and fingers, smelling of Jack Daniels and honey. She was hot, a deliberate coquette who never did without what she wanted, and she wanted to be unforgettable. She wanted to be a memory, a wound to every man arrogant enough to want her. She was the wrath of women in windows, fingering shades, old lace curtains, camouflage and despair, and stretch marks. So she glittered honestly,
delighted she was desired, and allowed those especially scheming, tactful suitors to experience her body and spirit, Taryn, so easily blending with theirs. And they were so happy and lay on her lime sheets, full and wet from her tongue. She kissed them reverently, even ankles, edges of beards. At 4:30 a.m., she rose. Moving the arms and legs that trapped her, she sighed, affirming the sculptured man, and made herself a bath of dark musk oil, Egyptian crystals, and Florida water to remove his smell, to wash away the glitter, to watch the butterflies melt into suds and the rhinestones fall beneath her buttocks like smooth pebbles in a Missouri creek. Laying in water, she became herself. Ordinary, brown, braided woman with big thighs, full lips, regular. Seriously intending to finish her night's work, she walked to her guest, straddled on her pillows, and began, "You'll have to go now. I have a lot of work to do, and I can't with a man around. Here are your pants. There's coffee on the stove. It's been very nice, but I can't see you again. You got what you came for, didn't you?" And she smiled. He would either mumble curses about crazy bitches or sit dumbfounded while she repeated, "I couldn't possibly wake up with a strange man in my bed. Why don't you go home?" She could have been slapped upside the head or verbally challenged, but she never was. And the ones who fell prey to the dazzle of hips painted with orange blossoms and magnolia-scented wrists had wanted no more than to lay between her sparkling thighs and planned on leaving before dawn. And she had been so divine, devastatingly bizarre the way her mouth bit round. And now she stood, a regular colored girl, full of the same malice, livid indifference as a sister, warm from supporting a would-be horn player or waiting by the window. And they knew, and they left in a hurry. She would gather her tinsel and jewels from the tub and laugh gaily or vengeful. And when she finished writing the account of her exploit in a diary embroidered with moonstones and lilies, she would place that silk rose behind her ear and cry herself to sleep. The world. And then I moved to Harlem. And now my universe is six blocks. When I walked into the Pacific, I imagine waters ancient from Acre, Tunis, cleansing me, feeding me. Now, my ankles are covered in gray filth from a puddle beneath the hydrant. My oceans were life. What waters I have here sit stagnant, circling old men's bodies, shit, and broken little whiskey bottles left to make me bleed. I used to live in the world, and then I moved to Harlem. My universe is now six blocks. A train and a tunnel where I could go anywhere, remaining a stranger. Yeah. Alone, a woman in the world, and then I moved to Harlem. I come in at dusk, stay close to the curb, hoping and praying that no young man would want me in the dark morning. It wouldn't be good,
not good at all to meet a tall, dark, short, brown man full of his power in the dark in my universe of six blocks, straight brick up walls, hanging women like old silk stockings, just cats crying, children giggling, a red tavern with red curtains, bad smells, kissing ladies, smiling and dirt spit walking sidewalks, men cursing and playing.
I spent more money yesterday than I did the day before, and that's more you nigga ever paid. Come here, bitch. Can't you see $5?
You're not here. Don't pay him no never mind, sister. Don't do your thing.
I used to live in the world. Really be in the world, free and sweet talking, good morning and thank yous and nice days. I can't now. I can't be nice to nobody. Nice is such a ripoff. Regular beauty and a smile in the street is just a setup. I used to live in the world, really be in the world, a woman in the world. I had a right to the world. Then I moved to Harlem for the setup, a universe of six blocks of cruelty piled up on itself. A tunnel closing.
Like a pyramid. Three friends, one laugh, one music, one flowered shawl knotted on each neck. We all saw him at the same time, and he saw us. I felt this quick thump in each one of us. Didn't know what to do. We all wanted what was coming our way, so we split. But he chose one, and she loved him. The other two were tickled and spurned his advances, while the one who loved him was somewhere else. He come to her saying, your friends love you so much, and they keep asking where you are when I've tried. She smiled, wondering how long her friends will hold out. He was all what they were looking for. He bided his time, he waited till romance waned. The three of us used to make up stories about used to and could have been nice. The season was dry. There were no men, no quickies, not one dance or eyes unrelenting. One day after another, except for the one who loved him, he appeared irregular, expecting graciousness no matter what. She cut up fresh strawberries. Her friends called less frequently. Went on hunts for passion fancies. She couldn't figure out what was happening. And then the rose she left by his pillow, she had found on her friend's desk. And there was nothing to say. She said, I have to tell you something. He's been after me the whole time. And saying that he's free and can't explain. What's going on with you has nothing to do with me. And I don't want to hurt you, but you know I need someone right now. And you know how wonderful he is. Her friend couldn't speak or cry. They hugged, then they went to where he was with another woman. He told one goodbye and told the other one he would call. He smiled a lot. She held her head on her lap. The lap of her sisters soaking up tears, each understanding how much love stood between them, love stood between them, love between them, love like sisters.
Ever since I realized there was someone called a colored girl, an evil woman, a bitch, or a nag, I've been trying not to be that and leave bitterness in somebody else's cup. Come to somebody to love me without deep, nasty, smelling scar from lie or being left screaming in a street full of lunatics whispering, bitch, bitch nigga, slut. Get out of that with all of that. I didn't have any of that for you. I brought you what joy I had, and I found joy. Honest fingers round my face, with dead musicians on 78s from Cuba or live musicians on $5 LPs from Chicago, where I've never been. And I love Willie Colon and Arsenio Rodriguez, especially because I can make the music loud enough so there can be no me but dance. And when I can dance like that, there's nothing could hurt me. But I get tired and I have to come off of the floor. And then there's that woman who hurts you, who left you 3 and 4 times, and you just went back. After you put my heart in the bottom of your shoe, you just walked back to where you hurt. So I didn't have nothing. That's when I went to somewhere where somebody had something for me. But he wasn't you. And I was on the way back from her house in the bottom of your shoe. So this is not a love poem. Because there are only memorial albums available. And even Charlie Mingus wanted desperately to be a pimp. And I won't be able to see Eddie Palmieri for months. So this is a requiem for myself. Because I have died in a real way. Not with aqua coffins or doo-wop Cadillacs I used to joke about when I was messing around. But a real dead love is here for you now. Because I don't know anymore. I don't know how to avoid my face, my own face, wet with tears, because I had convinced myself that color girls had no right to sorrow. And I lived and loved that way and kept sorrow on the curb. Allegedly for you, but I know I did it for myself. I couldn't stand it. I could not stand being sorry and colored all at the same time. It's so redundant in the modern world.
I lived with myths. And music was my old man. Could dance a dance at a time. Dance with no partners. Take my pills and keep right on stepping. Linger in non-English speaking arms, so there was no possibility of understanding. And you. You came in saying,
I am the nigga. I am the baddest motherfucker out there.
I said, yes, this is who I'm waiting for. And to come with you, I had to bring everything. The dance and the terror. The dead musicians and the hope. The scars hidden with smiles. And good fucking lay open. I don't know. I don't know any more tricks. I am really colored and really sad sometimes, and you hurt me more than I have ever danced out of into oblivion. Is it far enough to get me out of this? I am ready to die like a lily in the desert, and I couldn't let you in on it because I didn't know. Here's what I have. Poems. Big thighs, little tits, and so much love. Will you take this from me this one time? Please, please, this is for you. Arsenio Trace, clear the way for us and make me pure again. Please, please. Let me love you. I want you to love me. I don't want to dance with ghosts, snuggle up lovers I made up in my drunkenness. Oh, no. Let me love you just like I am, a color girl. I'm finally being real, no longer symmetrical and impervious to pain.
We deal with emotion too much. So why don't we just go on and be white then? And make everything dry and abstract with no rhythm and no reeling for sheer sensual pleasure. Yes, let's just go on and be white. We're right in the middle of it. No use holding on to ourselves. No use holding out. Let's think our way out of feeling. Let's abstract ourselves, some families, and maybe tonight I will find a way to make myself come without you. No fingers or other objects, just thought, which isn't spiritual. Ever evolution, cause it's empty, and godlessness is plenty, is ripe and fertile. Think it won't do me a bit of good tonight. I need to be loved and haven't the audacity to say, where are you? And I don't know who to say it to.
I have lost it. Touch with reality. I don't know who's doing it. I thought I was, but I was just so stupid. I was able to be hurt. And that's not real. Not anymore. I should be immune. If I'm still alive and that's what I was discussing, how am I still alive in my dependency on other living beings for love? I survive on intimacy. And tomorrow, that's all I've got going. And the music was like smack. And you knew about that and still refused that my dance was not enough. It's all I had. I was being alive and being a woman, and being colored is a metaphysical dilemma. I haven't conquered yet. Do you see the point? My spirit is too ancient to understand the separation of soul and gender. My love is too delicate to have thrown back on my face.
My love is too delicate to have thrown back on my
face. My love is too beautiful to have thrown back in my face.
My love is too sanctified to have thrown back in my face.
My love is too magic to have thrown back in my face.
My love is too Saturday night to have thrown back in my face.
My love is too complicated to have thrown back in my face.
My love is too music to have thrown back in my face.
Music.
Street, but somebody almost walked off with all my stuff. Like a kleptomaniac, working hard, forgetting while stealing. This ain't your stuff, this is mine. Now, why don't you put me back and let me hang out in my own self?
Yeah, right.
Somebody almost walked off with all my stuff and didn't leave a note to say, I was late for my solo conversations. Or two sizes too small for my own tacky skirt. What can anybody do with something of no value on an open market? Did you even get a dime for my thing? Hey man, with them glasses on your face, Mr. Louisiana Hot Lake, I want my stuff back. I want my rhymes and my voice. This is some delicate leg and whimsical kiss I gotta have to give to my choice, yeah, without you running off on a good thing. Mm-hmm. Now, you can't have me unless I give me away. And I was doing all of that till you run off with all my shit. I want my arm with the hot iron scar, my leg with the flea bite, callous feet, quick language back in my mouth, plantains, pineapple, pear juice, sunrise, Joseph, and Jules. I want my own things. How I lived them. How I was when I was there. You can't have them or do nothing with them. Stealing my shit from you don't make it yours. It makes it stolen. Somebody almost walked off with all my stuff. And I was standing there looking at myself the whole time. It wasn't a shadow that took my stuff. Mm-mm. It was a man whose ego walked around like Rodin's shadow. Was a man faster than my innocence. Was a lover. Somebody I made too much room for. Mm. Almost run off with all my stuff. And I didn't know I'd give it up so quick. And the one running with it don't know it got it, and I'm shouting, this is mine! And he don't know it got it. My stuff is the anonymous ripped off treasure of the year. Did you know somebody almost got away with me?
With you?
Me, in a plastic bag under their arm. Me, dangling on a string of personal carelessness. I'm spattered with mud and city rain. And no, I didn't get a chance to take a douche. Hey man, this is not your property. I need this pocket for me and my destiny so I can get around like good woman should to make the poem and the pop and the chicken and the dance. Why don't you find your own thing and leave this pack to me for my destiny? What I gotta do, I gotta have my stuff to do it with. To get around like good woman should.
That's right.
Why don't you find your own things and leave mine alone? What you gotta get from me? I give it to you. Yeah. I give it to you. Around 5 o'clock in the winter. When the sky's blue red, Dew City is getting pressed.
Warming up, girl.
If it's really my stuff, you gotta give it to me. If you really want it, I'm the only one can handle it. That nigga will be back tomorrow talking about, I'm sorry.
Last week, my old man came in saying, I don't know how she got your number, baby. I'm sorry.
No, this one is it. Oh, baby, you know I was high. I'm sorry.
No, look. I'm only human. And being inadequate is what makes us human. And if we was perfect, we wouldn't have nothing to strive for. So you gotta go and forgive me, pretty baby. Cause you know I'm so sorry.
Shut up, bitch. I told you I was sorry. No, listen. I do you like I do you. Cause I thought you could take it. I'm sorry.
Now you know that I know that you know that I can't love you like you want me to love you. I'm sorry.
One thing I don't need is any more apologies. I got sorry greeting me at my front door. You can keep yours. I don't know what to do with them. They don't open doors or bring the sun back. They don't make me happy or get a morning paper. Didn't nobody stop using my tears to wash cars because of a sorry. I'm simply tired of collecting. I didn't know I was so important to you. I'm gonna have to throw some away. I can't get to the clothes in my closet for all the sorries. I'm gonna tack a sign to my door, leave a message by the phone. If you call to say you're sorry, call somebody else. I don't use them anymore. I let sorry, didn't mean to, and how could I know about that? Take a walk on a dark and musty street in Brooklyn. I'm gonna do exactly what I want to, and I won't be sorry for none of it. Let a sorry soothe your soul. I'm gonna soothe mine. You were always inconsistent, doing something and being sorry. Beating my heart to death talking about you sorry. Well, I will not call. I'm not gonna be nice. I will raise my voice and scream and holler and break things and race the engine and tell all of your secrets about yourself to your face. And I will list in detail every one of my wonderful lovers and their ways. I will play Oliver Lake loud, and I won't be sorry for none of it. I loved you on purpose. I was open on purpose. I still crave vulnerability and close talk, and I'm not even sorry about you being sorry. You can carry all the guilt and grime you want, and just don't give it to me. I can't use another sorry. Next time, you should admit you're mean, low down, trifling, and no count straight off. Instead of being sorry all the time, enjoy being yourself.
Right, girl. Yeah.
Under his body like crumpled paper napkins in a summer park, and little specks of something from between his toes of the biscuits from the day before ran in the sweat that tucked the sheets into his limbs like he was an old frozen bundle of chicken or something.
and he'd get up to make coffee, drink wine, drink water. He'd wish one of his friends who knew where he was would come by with some blow or some shit, anything. There was no air. You see the spotlights in the alleyways downstairs moving in the air, cross his wall over his face and get under the covers, wait for an all clear or till he could hear traffic again. There wasn't nothing wrong with him. There wasn't nothing wrong with him. He kept telling Crystal, but any nigga that wanna kill Vietnamese children more, stay at home and raise his own is sicker than a rabid dog. And that's how the thing had been going since he got back. Crystal just got into saying what a fool nigga Bo was and had always been. Didn't he go all over uptown saying that the child wasn't his? Was some no-count bastards and any old city police could come get him if they wanted, cause as soon as the blood type and shit was together, everybody would know that Crystal was a no-good lying whore. And after this, she'd been his girl since she was 13 when he caught her on the stairway. Came home crazy as hell. Tried to get veterans benefits to go to school and they kept right on putting him in the remedial classes. He couldn't read worth a damn, so Bo accused the teachers of holding him back and got himself a gypsy cab to drive. But his cab kept breaking down and the cops was always messing with him. Plus, he wasn't getting much bread. But Crystal went and got pregnant again. Bo almost beat her to death when she told him. She still got a scar under her right tit where he cut her up. And still, Crystal went right on and had the baby. So now Bo really had two children. A little girl, Naomi Kenya, and a boy. Kwame Bo Willie Brown, and there was no air. How in the hell did he get in this mess anyway? Somebody went and told Crystal that Bo was spending all of his money on the bartending bitch down at the merry-go-round cafe. Bo sat straight up in the bed, wrapped in the sheets like John the Baptist or a huge baby with stubble and nuts. And now we had to get all that shit out of Crystal's mind so she would let him come home. Crystal had gone and got a court order saying that Bo Willie Brown had no access to his children. If he showed his face, he was subject to arrest. Shit, she'd been on his ass to marry her since she was 14 years old, and here, when she was 22, she wanna throw him out because he said he'll marry her? She burst out laughing, hollering, "What you wanna marry me for now? So I can support your ass or come sit with you when they lock your behind up? Because they gonna come for you, that goddamn lunatic. They gonna come, and I'm not gonna have a thing to do with it. Oh no, I wouldn't marry your pitiful black ass for nothing." And she went to bed. The next day, Bo Willie came in blasted and got to swinging chairs at Crystal, who couldn't figure out what the hell he was doing till he got to shouting about how she was gonna marry him and get some more veterans benefits and he could stop driving them crazy spics around while they trying to kill him for $15. Bo was sweating terrible, beating on Crystal, and he couldn't do no more with the tables and chairs, so he went and got the high chair, and Lil Kwame was in it. And Bo was beating Crystal with the high chair and her son. And some notion got into him to stop, and he ran out. Crystal almost died. That's why the police wouldn't allow Bo nowhere near where she lived. And she'd been telling the kids their daddy tried to kill her and Kwame, and he just wanted to marry her, that's what. He wanted to marry her and have a family, but the bitch was crazy. Bo Willie was sitting in his hotel in his drawers, drinking coffee and wine in the heat of the day, spilling shit all over himself, laughing about how he was gonna get Crystal to take him back. Let him be a man in the house. She wouldn't even have to go to work no more. He got dressed up all in his Irish suit and checkered pants to go see Crystal and get all this mess cleared up. He knocked on the door to Crystal's rooms and she didn't answer. He beat on the door and Crystal and Naomi started crying. Bo got to shouting again how he wanted to marry her and was she gonna always be a whore or did she want a husband? And Crystal just kept on right on screaming for him to leave us alone, just leave us alone. So Bo broke the door down. Crystal held the children in front of her. She picked Kwame up off the floor in her arms, and she held Naomi by her shoulders and kept on saying, "Bo Willie Brown, get out of here. The police is gonna come for you, you fool, get out of here. Do you want the children to see you act a fool again? You want Kwame to get brain damage from you throwing him around, nigga, get out of here. Get out and don't you show your ass again or I'll kill you. I swear I'll kill you." He reached for Naomi. Crystal grabbed the little girl and stared at Bo Willie like he was a leper or something. "Don't you touch my children, motherfucker, I'll kill you." Bo Willie jumped back all humble and apologetic. "I'm sorry. I don't want to hurt him. I just want to hold him and get on my way. I don't want to cause you no more trouble. I wanted to marry you and give you things." "What you gonna give? A broken jaw, nigga? Get out of here." He ignored Crystal's outburst and sat down motioning for Naomi to come to him. She smiled back at her daddy. Crystal felt Naomi giving in and held her tighter. Naomi pushed away and ran to her daddy. "Daddy,
Daddy, come back, Daddy. Come back, but be nice to Mommy, because Mommy loves you, and you gotta be nice. And he sat her on his knee, played with her ribbons, and they counted fingers and toes. Every so often, he looked over to Crystal, holding Kwame like a statue. And he'd say, see, Crystal, I can be a good father. Now let me see my son. She didn't move. And he coaxed her and he coaxed her, told her she was still a hot little old thing and pretty and strong. Didn't she get right back up after the little old fight they had and go back to work? Bo Willie oozed kindness. And Crystal, who had known so little, let Bo hold Kwame. As soon as Crystal let the baby out of her arms, Bo jumped up laughing and giggling and hooting and hollering, all right, bitch, you gonna marry me? You gonna marry me? I ain't gonna marry you. I ain't ever gonna marry you for nothing. You're gonna be in jail. You're gonna be under the jail for this. Now give me my kids. Yeah, give me back my kids. He kicked the screen out of the window and held the kids off of the sill. You gonna marry me? Yeah, I'll marry you. Anything but bring the children back in the house. He looked from where the kids were hanging from the fifth story and all the people screaming at him, and he started sweating again. Say to all the neighbors, you're gonna marry me. I stood by Bo in the window when Naomi reached for me and called me screaming, Mommy, Mommy, from the fifth story, but I could only whisper. And he dropped him.
Her branches and held me in the breeze, made me dawn dew, that chill at daybreak. The sun wrapped me up, swinging rose light everywhere. The sky laid over me like a million men. I was cold, I was burning up, a child, and endlessly weaving garments for the moon with my tears. I found God in myself, and I loved her. I loved her fiercely.
And this is for colored girls who have considered suicide, but are moving to the edges of their own